Radiant Team Pick.
What on earth? Oh. That's my bad.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Betway WCA 2016 European Bracket. We've got one more best of three coming up for you today. It's going to be Kaipi versus Elements One. An interesting matchup. Elements One, one of the teams to jump into the bracket very late in the game. They were the replacement for Liquid because they didn't have their new roster ready to rock and roll. And of course, Kaipi, a lot of familiar faces that you'll recognize over there. So let's not delay any longer. Hop right into the draft. I'm Zayori, joined for this series by Android. Annie, what's going on? How you feeling today?
Hey, feeling pretty good. Hopping back on the mic for the first time since TI, so we've obviously got a great match here. Purple versus Red. Let's see what Kaipi are going to do to keep that streak alive.
Yep, absolutely. Kaipi, very heavy favorites coming into this one. The Betway odds are like over 3x payout for Elements One, and I think like a 1.45 for Kaipi or something like that. A couple of familiar faces over there. I do recognize Milan and Mitch, as well as Swift Ending. I'm forgetting which team they used to be on, but they've been... They've been around for a while. Of course, Kaipi, Bone 7, Pylai, Dai, Sing Sing, Sexy Bambo, and the Mysterious 33. No idea who the 33 is. That could be literally anyone.
Yeah, I was looking around. Apparently, he's a Battle Cup winner, so we are dealing with a polished professional here.
Whoa, look out. Battle Cup winners. They're serious business. So, Shadow Demon Beastmaster, the opener for Kaipi, and Faceless Void Darkseer here for Elements 1. Faceless Void, man, he has been the talk of this tournament. So far, he has been first pick or first banned in every single game of this edition of WCA 2016. So, not surprised to see Elements 1 falling into line here.
I mean, is he just played as a position 1? Because with Darkseer snapped up so early, it seems like you kind of try to tease that offlane position a little bit. But I think they're just going straight in. Elements 1 know what they want, and they're going for it.
Yeah, you lose some of the mystery, but it's been a pretty even spread, actually, between position 1 safe lane Void and position 3 offlane Void. Bulldog played Void in that last game we saw, game 2 of the series earlier, but position 1 Void works pretty well. It changes the dynamic a little bit. You don't need a lineup that totally synergizes with the Chrono if Void's the big damage dealer that's in the Chrono actually killing people. So it does give you some cool options to open up the draft and maybe, you know, make things a little bit less predictable. I think at this point, the whole Wombo combo in the Chrono has kind of run its course, and teams are looking for more well-rounded drafts rather than the drafts that just look for that one big fight to end the game, you know, past the 30-minute mark.
Yeah, I mean, the Wombo combo is not so hot, but something like an Invoker still could be a fantastic pickup for either team.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, Invoker making it through. The only issue is I have no idea if Elements 1 actually have a good Invoker player.
I mean, Invoker's at this point, like from the patches you've been playing, if you're on a professional team, you can play Invoker. You can manage.
Is Elements 1 a professional team, though?
Hell yeah, dude. I've played in the WCA. What have you done with your life?
Semi-professional, you know. I know what you mean, though. At this point, if you don't have a good Invoker player, you've got something wrong with your team. He's been in the meta for quite some while. Interesting bans from Kaipi, though. The Death Prophet, maybe not so crazy, but Outworld Devourer, we've seen him picked up a little bit, but seeing him banned out here is kind of peculiar. I guess he does do a lot of damage outside of the Chrono, so there's a lot of synergy there for the potential team fight of Elements 1.
All right, so looking, I mean, they still have to pick up both their supports. I think the days of, you know, just going in and smashing out the Shadow Demon are kind of waning, so I'm not quite sure how much use Kaipi's going to get out of that, but Elements 1 still have a pretty full pool. Looking at the heroes that are banned out, there's still a heap of nice utility supports they could grab.
Yeah. A lot of options indeed, except for Oracle. That's pretty much the only option they don't have. Smart stuff from Elements 1, though, to ban out some of the illusion carries. Kaipi still have the Morphling at their disposal to utilize the Shadow Demon illusion harassment. One of the main reasons you pick up a Shadow Demon like this, I mean, it's a great versatile support that can stack, do a lot of damage, all that stuff, but ultimately, late game, it's a lot easier if you have somebody strong that can make illusions. Again, we saw it even earlier today in game 1 of that Alliance series. Morphling can get to this point where Shadow Demon Illusions themselves can just cripple a base, but here we go. A nice synergistic pick with the team fight they've already got picked up. The Morana, most likely a mid lane core, though not too often you see all three cores picked up straight away, so it does provide a little flexibility, perhaps a support for Elements 1, but either way, good synergy with the Faceless Void, set up for arrows, and if she is a core, once you get that Aghanim's, the damage output is real.
Yeah, something I'm thinking from Kaipi. I think I've seen them go for it a couple of times. Pick up that Beastmaster for the offlane, throw a Bambo on that, and then get Sing Sing and Enchantress and just go nuts. Go completely crazy for the first 10 minutes and push and get summons for days. You can gank very easily, especially with a Shadow Demon. But Disruptor's going to be picked up as one of those nice utility supports that we're talking about, and we'll see where Kaipi run from there.
Yeah, great team fight. Amazing to have against Darkseer and Morana, too. Really mobile heroes. We've seen a lot of Kunkka priority, you know, the X marks the spot style, and Disruptor definitely plays in a similar vein. And they needed some good team fight. Shadow Demon and Beastmaster are both great heroes, but much more single target oriented. So Disruptor helps fill that void. And speaking of voids, it's an anti-mage. Fourth pick. All right.
That is certainly a ballsy play. I mean, we're seeing Bounty Hunters picked up in a game where, you know, Elements 1 might not be starting with the most intense power spike, so that Bounty Hunter is going to be a big risk factor. I don't know. He doesn't play well from behind.
I don't know about the Bounty Hunter. I kind of agree with you. It seems like kind of an odd pick into this draft. I feel like it puts a lot of pressure on him to really harass the mid lane. I mean, good luck picking on a Beastmaster in the off lane. One of the tankier, more survivable. Probably going to spend a lot of time in the jungle. So Bounty Hunter can leech experience and be annoying on that front, but that just feels so lackluster to me. If the Bounty Hunter messes up once and dies pre-level 6 and those kind of, I am just leeching experience scenarios, if he gets glimpsed back into a kinetic field where they have Dust or a Sentry, all that experience he leeches kind of goes by the wayside and it ends up becoming a gain for Kaipi. So a high-risk pick. I also don't think it synergizes with Void that well. I mean, the movement speed helps with what they've got going on here, right? They can help initiate, get team fights going on, and he can throw Shurikens into the Void ult, but you know, it's not the same as like a Disruptor, for example, who can follow up on Void really well and effectively.
Yeah, I mean, you look at these team fights. Who's Bounty Hunter actually going to go on? Like, whose heals is he going to nip at? Like, maybe tapping the Disruptor, touching the Shadow Demon, yes. But there's very little he can accomplish, especially
it's a Bambo
with the Tiny.
Yes! I can't wait for this. This is going to be great. Mid Tiny, obviously, safe lane, anti-mage, and off lane Beastmaster, most likely. I have high expectations here. I have still vivid memories of the Elimination Mode tournament where Bambo went absolutely ham. We saw a Sand King. We saw some Tiny plays. This is good stuff. I think Kaipi very much in their comfort zone with this draft. A lot of team fight, a lot of disable, and pretty darn good late game as well. Beastmaster, Anti-Mage, Tiny, they will all scale pretty nicely. The Inner Beast is great with these heroes. They can get up a Vlad's, eventually get an AC, all these kind of good aura-based team fight items. I really like what they've got going on here. I think they can deal with this Void. Shadow Demon alone is pretty good at dealing with people caught in Chrono with either aggressive or defensive disruptions. Same deal with Disruptor. And now Enchantress for Elements 1. Another very bold pick here. It really is.
Elements are trying to style on Kaipi, picking up their signature heroes and just kind of going in. I love what Kaipi are putting together. I'll be very surprised if Elements 1 can make this work synergistically, but I mean, they do have some combos. There's the Chronosphere and Chandra's whacking away with Impetus Strikes and Morana setting up with arrows. I really don't know how much use they're going to get out of the bounty, but we could be totally proven wrong.
Well, it's cool to see the Enchantress picked up here with the Void because they have options for greed. Like, if Kaipi don't put a lot of pressure on and play a greedier style, this opens up for the Enchantress to scale as a damage dealing force. You could go Midas, Ags, Dragon Lance, you know, all those classic items, and actually do a fair bit of damage and work well with the team. But I don't think that's the strategy Elements 1 wants to go for. I don't think you want to go late game versus Kaipi.
Look at Kaipi's roles. They are really switching stuff up.
So Sing Sing takes the Tiny, Bambo takes the Shadow Demon. All right, well, a little bit less excited.
It was their old offlaner. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So this is all right, though. I mean, it's still the same basic setup. They're going to switch things around a little bit, but Anti-Mage safe lane, Tiny middle, and Beastmaster taking the or 3-3 taking the Beastmaster. Twitch chat tells me this individual is named the Coon, and erupted with it. I feel like it was too coordinated to be a troll effort, so I will believe, though that name is suspect.
No, he was their offlaner at one point. I just don't know if this is...
He's a real person. I don't know where the 33 came from, but see what happens here. Big rotation from Kaipe.
They're going in. There's a big smoke. They could absolutely get caught out. Bambo goes and gets the disrupt off. They're looking for something. They got the punish. Avalanche to follow up, and it looks like Mitch might be fresh out of luck. He's holding on to that skill point, but I don't think Surge is going to save it here. LeBron tries to throw out a couple of spears, but it's not enough to save the cute little Darkseer. Bone7 ends up getting the credit for that. So nice start for the anti-mage.
I will say, very smart choice from Mitch not to level up Surge there. That is more crippling than dying at this stage. Ion Shell level 1 is required for Darkseer to do anything, especially if the other team sees that he has Surge, then the supports know that they can just hard harass him, zone him out, and there's really nothing he can do. And he doesn't have Ion Shell to kill stuff in the jungle. So unfortunate that he died, but absolutely the right play not to panic Surge there, because that would have just compounded things even more, I think.
All right, so going in, it looks like the Bounty Runes are going to be a 1-1 split, but again, Kaipe already starting out with a nice chunk of gold on their anti-mage and some experience, too. He's going to level up quite quickly. Do you think there's really anything Elements is going to have to do to keep him in check?
Their mid layer in check? The Sing Sing Tiny?
The anti-mage, dude. He's going to get huge. It's Bone7, boy.
It's going to be hard for them to stop this anti-mage from farming, honestly. You know, you always pick a Darkseer. Well, maybe not always exclusively, but a lot of reasons to pick a Darkseer. But one of the main things about him is the lane dominance. You and I have talked about it a lot. An anti-mage, one of the better heroes at dealing with it. Spell Shield, the ability to just mana drain him so he can't spam out these Ion Shells as much as he'd like. They will start to skirmish down here, but I don't know how this is going to go for Elements. It's still a 3-on-2.
Oh, the dust! They are able to get it off. Now Milan is in trouble to blink forward from Bone7. They do get off the kinetic field. More swipe. That Gondar goes down. They're looking for a follow-up kill. Darkseer continues to charge in. They will bring in LeBron, tossing out those spears, trying to get a slam dunk, but it looks like Bambo just weaseling his way out of this. They aren't able to get the follow-up, and Bambo will end up getting out alive. Kinetic field to keep him super safe.
All right, Bone7. Picking up a freebie there. It seemed ambitious from Elements 1 in that scenario. Like, sure, you initiate, you have a go, you harass the support, but they committed pretty hard. I mean, anti-mage, not known as a great hard hitter at these early levels, but still, he's mobile. Those right clicks hurt. You can't just charge in 2v3 and expect to be able to shut down the Shadow Demon like that. So backfires. Kaipe up 2-0. Great start for them. 500 net worth, 500 experience in the first minute of gameplay. A lot of pressure on these supports. Milan and LeBron. I like this. Enchantress level 1 in enemy territory. This is so all in, though. When you have two roaming supports like this, if they do not find kills, these two will be so far behind, and they just become food for heroes like Tiny and Anti-Mage. Even Beastmaster, you know, he gets a timely Necro Book. These heroes will die very, very quickly. They're even sharing experience in these camps, which is making it all the worse. Both of them less than halfway through level 1.
It's not looking so hot for Elements. You look at what Kaipe's doing in their lanes, and top lane's going fantastically. Kuhn's sitting back, he's got himself some decent last hits, getting some very good levels, almost level 4. Down in this bottom lane, I mean, Bone7, he is just feasting upon Elements here as Pylai die, doing what he needs to, getting the pulls off. He could actually be in a little bit of trouble here. Milan going through, debating whether he wants to reveal here, but doesn't opt to pop that little strike, and now you've just got Enchantress kind of doing her thing, trying to creep cut, but how effective a use of her time is that, really?
I mean, so far it has not been very effective. Again, both of them level 1. Shadow Demon's also level 1 himself, but they're just... This seems very ambitious and forced to me. Milan very low on mana. The Bounty Hunter doesn't provide that much at only level 1. Even just having a Janata would make a big difference to initiate with slows and try and get these Centaurs or Hellbear Smashers in position. They might even just get a free Centaur kill here. Does get denied by LeBron. That's nice, but how nice is it really?
With his life. Yeah, he's going to be coming back in. The illusion's immediately cleared up, but they do end up getting the kinetic field off. They are going to have Enchantress trapped in, but Radiant, they opt to back off for now. Bone7 salving up. We'll see if he wants to dive back through. There's a Mango munched up by the Darkseer. He might want to reinitiate with either a Escape Surge or maybe an aggressive Ion Shell, but here he's going. Mitch taking some smacks to the back of the head. Bone7 still looking around, but just cleanup crew coming out. Kaipe aren't scared.
You watch all this fighting and you're tempted to sort of think, well, at least they're distracting the anti-mage. He's not really farming. But then you open up the CS chart, and he's not behind at all. He's within one or two CS of all the other cores. Everyone's farming pretty well. Bounty Hunter will deny himself to Roche, take that free trip back to the well. But I would say so far, these rotations from elements have been less than effective. The Beastmaster, haven't really checked in on this offlane, but he's doing quite well. Almost level 5. Hasn't had to retreat to the jungle. He has just a regular Quelling Blade, no Iron Talon. Not that often he gets to just farm in lane, but there's not much the Void can do to stop him from farming, so it's just a farm fest. And I think, at least in this little window, that really benefits Kaipi. As soon as Beastmaster hits 6, he can smoke up, start moving around, even just TPing to a lane, dropping a Primal Roar on this level 2 Enchantress. That's a game, or a fight-winning play right there.
Oh, mid lane, there could be a little bit of trouble, but again, ambushing a Tiny is a lot easier said than done. Now, Bambo might end up just eating up the damage from this. Goes for the self-disrupt. Will his team be able to rotate in time? He has something there. He's going to get slowed down. Janata coming back in. One strike from the low ground means Enchantress will secure her first kill. Disruptor coming in, trying to patrol the area, but he could actually be in a little bit of trouble himself.
Yeah, good rotation finally from Elements 1. I mean, they've spent a lot of time in enemy territory. Maybe Sexy Bambo just thinking that there's no way they've been lingering and so deep on their side of the map for so long. But nobody nearby. It's one of those spots where there's no easy access point, no tower to TP to. So not much Kaibi could do to save him. At the end of the day, just a Shadow Demon of all the heroes to fall is probably... They're number one candidate at this stage of the game. As Purge was saying earlier, Shadow Demon can handle being a little bit underleveled in this early stage because disruption is really all that matters at this stage.
All right, we're going to have a skirmish down in the bottom lane as Bounty Hunter. I mean, he's trying so hard to get something done, but he's still level 2 at this point, almost 6 minutes into the game.
He's got a little bit of movement speed now. That helps.
Yeah,
there we
go. Got...
Ion Shell, baby. This is it.
Oh, Bambo knows something's up, though, and Bambo is still sitting on a desk. He's going to get a Janata right there. The self-disrupt comes out. Bone 7 here, but it looks like Bambo might end up paying the ultimate price. He does
there
go down.
We
can
go.
Bone 7 find anything out of this? He's now surrounded. There's going to be a centaur stomp and a clap, but no, that's not happening. Bone 7 just backs on out of there. We'll be completely fine. Mid lane,
very
though.
Nice. Finally starting to get some progress here. They knew Pylai Dai was mid. He was showing he's been around the Tiny, so 3v2 makes a big difference, whereas before they were trying to force this 2v3. Moonlight Shadow dropped by Elements 1. Mirana for this rune, and Tiny just bottles it up.
It's pretty devastating. Oh, Mirana's going to pick up a little bit of gold there, getting out Beastmaster's Hawk.
Beastmaster is the highest level in the game right now. It's kind
bottom
of insane.
Lane. Got Bone 7 kind of wrapping around the trees. There's going to be Mitch trying to do what he can. I mean, this Darkseer is tanky. He's putting out some decent damage from those level 3 Ion Shells, but I mean, just getting Bone 7 out of lane is huge.
A little bit surprised that Kaipi are spreading their supports around so much and allowing them to bully the Anti-Mage. He's going to lose his tower pretty soon here, which will also make his life a little bit more difficult. They are letting Sexy Bambo sit in the off lane to leech some XP as the Beastmaster starts roaming about looking for that first gank. So finding some efficiency that way. It seems like it'll cost him a tower. They drop the glyph, and still no rotations in sight.
I mean, they could make up for this by just rotating in the mid lane. They've got Pylad Eye sitting back, and Tiny's perfectly formidable for pushing right now, just clearing out waves, getting what he wants to. We haven't talked a whole lot about the Mirana, who, you know, is sitting in the mid lane. She's got herself a Wraith Band. She's got herself a decent chunk of gold, but in terms of CS, kind of getting walked on by the rest of her team.
She's dead even with the Tiny. I think this mid lane's... probably about as even as it gets between these two heroes. If they can actually kill the Mirana, this rotation's good, but not an easy hero for the Beastmaster to initiate on. She's going to see it coming from a mile away and should be able to leap back in pretty much every scenario unless Tiny can catch her with an avalanche. Back to farming we go. Maybe slightly better for Bone 7 now that this bottom lane is pushed in. We'll see if he can keep the equilibrium in his favor. If he can kind of stay around this area, it makes it a lot harder for elements to rotate in safely because they have to commit so deep into enemy jungle. Mid lane. Sing Sing just harassing.
Yeah, I like the choice to keep Pilot Eye in the mid lane, just making sure that Sing Sing can push and not feel super scared. Now, in terms of our overall vision game, we are going to have nothing for Disruptor, and Pilot Eye there is going to be carrying out, or rather, Sexy Bambo is going to be picking up only one dust.
Oh,
so there's...
wow.
Oh, my. That was... Oh,
he almost got hit by the arrow,
but the roar
too.
Comes in, connects. They can at least find something for this. They know where he's at. Milan, though, might be able to scoot away. Do they actually have vision for him? No, the wild axe is off the mark. They go, they turn, they get the slow. And now it looks like 3-3 could be in some trouble. Gonna get picked off by Enchantress's Hellbear creep. Oh, no. That's not what Kaipi wanted.
Yeah, not so good. This aggression from Elements 1 is actually starting to work out. Bounty Hunter now level 5, Enchantress now level 5 as well. These kills are starting to add up, and that first rotation from the Beastmaster wasn't nearly as scary as I thought. I really thought that he would start to move right as he hits level 6, try to catch the enemies off guard, but didn't have a great opportunity, and instead he just kept farming, and now Elements are feeling like they're in a pretty good spot. You look at that gold graph, and they're now 3,000 gold ahead, 2,000 experience.
Yeah, I mean, it looked like really, really before strong track. Early lanes for Kaipi, but Elements are somehow pulling it out. They're getting a kill advantage, and I think most importantly, they've been forcing Bone7 out of lane. He hasn't been getting that free farm that he was getting minute 1-5.
I still can't believe the supports have left him alone so much, or even just having one support down here so they can't just bully him behind the tower. It's starting to add up. You know, he was doing pretty well, and honestly, I think Bone7's doing very well given that he's been in this weird 1v3 scenario more often than not. He's got 2 kills, hasn't died once, still 42 CS. Arrow will not connect, but all this pressure is making his life really hard. Even just battling last hits against the tower, let alone these heroes, makes it more difficult for him.
Oh. Over here in the river, there was a little bit of a throwdown. Faceless Void was able to get drop down the Shadow Demon. Not the most important kill in the world, and he did drop a chrono for it.
Still.
And Sing Sing sitting back and is able to farm on this high ground, so not the worst trade in the world.
Yeah, it's still great, though, for this swift ending. Faceless Void, number one on net worth by a nice chunk, 1k up on the Anti-Mage. They're not going to use that chrono to team fight anytime soon anyhow, so using it for just a quick pickoff like that to boost his bottom line is all the better. I think completely worth it. Curious what build he's going for here. Is this just a Lincoln Sphere Void opener? I don't think it's a Vanguard Void. Lincoln Sphere seems to be the style that's in vogue right now.
I mean, Lincoln Sphere is definitely possible, but I wouldn't completely rule out Vanguard. I think I've seen enough Voids go for it at this point that it makes a little bit of sense, just being that frontliner that can go in, kind of resist a little bit of what Anti-Mage is throwing at you, because there's really no one else that's ultra tanky on Elements.
Well, the Darkseer will be kind of a frontliner as well, but I think it's also just a good game to have Lincolns. They don't have a ton of single
smoke
target.
Rotation.
Break it, but Disruption, Primal Roar, a lot of things that it can block. What are they going to find here? Oh, Enchantress. It's an easy pickoff. Okay,
Sing Sing
with a dominating streak. Wow, that's a lot of gold for that seemingly easy kill, but back to the mid now.
Yeah, they're wrapping around there. Moonlight Shadow going to fade out. And yeah, just some easy push onto the tower, but I think Elements are doing a great job just kind of putting bodies where the bodies need to be in order to force out the big cores and force out the rotations.
Yeah, they will still have to deal with this Tiny, though. Sing Sing at that point where he almost has the peak of his burst potential before more of those big items come out. You know, someone like Enchantress, even though she's done pretty well in this early game, is still food. Same with the Bounty Hunter, level 6, he's still very squishy. Tiny combo plus one of pretty much anything else is a guaranteed kill at this stage.
No smoke going to come up. It will be popped out. They are going to be going through Arrow. Max on the pile, I die. And there's going to be a couple of stacks of Shadow Poison, but can they really follow up here onto Milan? The track goes out, so they know where Bambo's at, and there will be a disruption here. It looks like the Bounty Hunter does not make it out of this one alive. He's going to try his damnedest, but nope, in the end, Shadow Demon picks up his first kill of the game.
Nice use of the Sentry Ward there. No options for him, just caught in a little bit too deep. Now up top, looks like a defense is coming its way. Void with the Perseverance, so more likely to be that Lincoln's. Unless it's a Battle Fury, I guess you never know. Position 1, Void, he could go Farmville. I think very unlikely, but
dude, it's 2012 now. Now there's the Centaur Stomp coming back in. There's going to be a nice little Static Storm, but no Kinetic Field to keep anyone locked in. It might just be enough damage there with the Glimpse to bring him back through, but Swift Ending feeling completely fine. Goes for the Chrono, Sing Sing walks into it, taking Impetus Strikes. They're focusing on Sexy Bambo. They are able to get the kill
on that.
Looks like the Leap Forward from Mirana might be enough. They drop the Star Storm, Pilot Eye falls, and they leap forward, and they're going to get Sing Sing as well, most likely. He can turn around, he can Avalanche.
Dead.
Can he run? He goes for the Toss. Do they have any sort of long-range follow-up? There is going to be the Leap back forward. It looks like they're just out of range of an Impetus Strike from Enchantress.
All right, well done by Sing Sing at the end there to keep himself alive with the toss, but very convincing fight for Elements. Faceless Void maximizing his potential. Huge burst damage completely mitigated by Time Walk. He goes back in, drops the Chrono, sets up for the Arrow. He is now very comfortable, number one on net worth. They get this Tier 1 tower. Mirana benefits from that quite a bit as well. She's now about 1,200 gold away from the Aghanim Scepter at 13 minutes. That's pretty damn good. Things starting to fall in line for Elements 1. Now, the one drawback, though, is Bone7 is finally getting some space to farm, and he is farming well. Number 3 on net worth overall, and just a little bit behind that of the Mirana, making progress towards his assured Battle Fury. Perseverance up with another 700 gold in tow.
Yeah, I mean, Kaipi, again, they're first 3 minutes of laning phase were fantastic, but after that it seems like they just kind of tried to make too much happen at once, and elements, they kind of stuck to their guns, they went for really nice rotations, and they did get important pickoffs. And we'll see if Milan's able to do anything to chase Bone 7 away, but he's just back to farming. Also, he should be able to get his first big item relatively soon.
Either underestimating the void or really overestimating their damage. Sexy Bambo does not have a point in Soul Catcher. I think if he had that instead of the second point in Disruption, they probably could have killed the void there. Really curious why he opted for this second point in Disruption. Generally speaking, it's a one-point wonder until you get to the late game. It scales notably poorly. The cooldown reduction is not that significant. The illusion duration, well, you know, like level 1 to level 4, that 8 to 14 makes a difference, but level 2 is not a value point at all, especially when you don't have a hero that you can, you know, use the illusions on. I think that 1 point Soul Catcher is way better. Yeah, Swift Ending. He's dead.
That is a swift ending of his life, and now LeBron just kind of galloping around and not really able to do anything to save throughout, like, one impetus strike throughout that. But, oh, they're going to go back in. They go for the toss back onto the catapult. She goes for this Roinx. She might just be able to live through the avalanche latching. There is no way. She's going to get stuck in the kinetic field. They opt to put the roar out as well to keep her locked down. A big commit there, use of ultimates, but in the end, they do get 2 kills.
Yeah, pretty worth it. They realized at the end the Untouchable was starting to get a little bit scary, and a quick TP rotation possibly could have turned that around. You don't know exactly how much gold the Mirana has. Maybe she TPs in with an Aghanim's and obliterates your team. So better safe than sorry. Drop the extra damage and just get out. I mean, it's not a very long cooldown on the Primal Roar. Better to use it and secure the kill than get greedy and roll the dice and have the chance that the other team's able to react and finish you off. Bone 7 still farming up a storm down here. So is the Tiny, for that matter. Blink Dagger up on Sing Sing now with his phase boots, so a lot of mobility and potential catch on him.
Yeah, we'll see. Kaipi now getting the items they need in terms of, you know, having their kit really complete. It's all about the levels for Shadow Demon and Disruptor, but like you mentioned, Tiny with the Blink, you've got Beastmaster now picking up the Necros. He's going to be saving up towards, you know, either his Blink or higher level Necros to be able to go and start smacking away at the towers. Anti-Mage getting very, very close to that Battle Fury, and how do you think that's going to change the pace of the game? Is Element still looking strong, or is that when Kaipi start to peak?
Battle Fury? Definitely not when they start to peak. Yeah, that is like the beginning of Anti-Mage. Like, that is the first act completion, I think. First intermission, and then he's ready to start farming and get big. And it doesn't really change the pace of the game too much for Kaipi. They still need this Anti-Mage to come online. I would imagine Beastmaster just goes straight for the Necro level 3, mostly for the detection. It makes the Bounty Hunter's life a lot more difficult, and it also gives him more kill potential. The Mana Burn really comes in handy. Just a lot of utility over the Blink Dagger, because they have an Initiator already. They've got Glimpse with the Disruptor, they've got Blink Tiny. I think another Blink at this point on the Beastmaster is just overkill. We'll see a little tower exchanging tier 1 up top for the tier 1 mid. Definitely favoring Elements 1. This does open up the Dire Jungle a little bit, but still getting rid of those access points for the Radiant is so important and does give them a little more Roshan potential. They don't really have a great Roshan team, but without that tower there, hard
smoke
for Kaipi to react.
Smoke coming back in.
Ags on Mirana.
Oh, the high ground. Oh, the Vacuum Wall! They are able to get off the Static Storm before Disruptor drops, and there might be enough there to turn the kills. They are able to get one down, two down.
No.
They're crossing the wall, and there's going to be Wild Axes spraying every which way, but 33 might not be so lucky. He's going for the TP out. They have anything to cancel it. They get the track off, but they aren't able to lock him down.
That was fabulous for Elements. Perfect timing as well. The Aghanim Scepter on Mirana was just completed before they started that, was not revealed, and Kaipi were not expecting that extra round of burst damage at all. You could tell immediately they saw it, they tried to run, but the damage had been done. Now you're not getting away from this team in that scenario. Very nice.
Absolutely, and again, just the smoke popping, it was high ground versus low ground, so high ground is always just a little bit better in terms of vision. If you're the Radiant in that situation, you know your smoke popped, you know you're screwed, but you're not quite sure what's coming at you from what angle, but either way, Elements looking really, really strong in terms of overall net worth. It's still going to be in their favor by a fair amount, even with Anti-Mage free farming.
Yeah, I mean, this is also the point where track gold starts to add up a little bit. What looks like an even trade in the fight will end up being a net gain for Elements overall, just because Bounty Hunter has that extra little bit. They will indeed go for Roche after those pickoffs, feeling a little better about it. The Alpha Wolf does make this slightly easier with the extra damage, and of course, the Untouchable on Enchantress. One of many things that she can do with this spell.
Oh man, those 4 points in time lock. Void is having a fun time here in the Roche pit.
Yeah, Dragonlance also up on the Enchantress, so LeBron is starting to come online a little bit. Power Tread to Aghanim Scepter, probably the next item choice for him, I think, no doubt. Curious what Sing Sing's going to do. It looks like Shadow Blade will be his next choice. The amulet's already up.
Yep, so, ultra mobility.
Yeah.
Yep. As soon as the Roshan went down, it looks like Kai P were like, we do not want to fight. Bail out, go top. But elements are hot on their trail. They're going in. It looks like they don't have any more smokes to expend, but they still might go in and try to get something done regardless. There's almost Greaves completed on the Darkseer.
Elements 1 need to be very careful about this anti-mage. They're giving Bone 7 a lot of space. They went from, hey guys, let's shut down the anti-mage, to let's focus on everything except the anti-mage. And it's safe to say that Bone 7 has completely recovered. Though, maybe he walks into a sticky situation. Moonlight Shadow, arrow, off the mark.
Still gonna go through. They will spray out some tracks here. They could start to focus on the Beastmaster, but he's kind of cutting his team away, making sure they're able to go in and fight on these choke points if they want to. There is gonna be Sexy Fambo doing what he can from the low ground. Again, is gonna be spraying out a bit of damage, takes the track, and just walking back a little bit of no man's land here. But Elements definitely on the offensive. Kaipi still on the defensive, waiting on that anti-mage to really blossom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, their timing isn't now, and if Elements win another fight, we're starting to get to that stage where Anti-Mage is really farmed, but the rest of his team is comparatively poor, especially his supports. Huge disparity there. 4k net worth on the Enchantress, 3.5 on Bounty Hunter, Disruptor down at a humble 2.5, and as Elements 1 continue to put pressure around the map, that disparity will continue to grow. And remember, they do always have the Faceless Void, who is a pretty effective counter against the Anti-Mage mobility with that Chronosphere once he gets the right clicks going on. He does also have the Lincoln Sphere completed now, so he's a lot more tanky. Can't just jump in and hit him with a Primal Roar like they can with the other heroes. Anti-Mage with some Split Push, forces out a Glyph down bottom, but Elements will get this Tier 2 mid.
I think overall, definitely a great trade for Elements. We'll see how far Anti-Mage can really push them before they react, but Elements go in, they get their tower, they force rotations, and most importantly, they just keep control on the rest of the heroes. There's going to be Sing Sing going back, and he's got that amulet. They do have the lockdown on Enchantress, the glimpse back slightly outside the range of the kinetic field, so they aren't able to keep that deer where they want her, unfortunately enough for Kaipi.
Almost a good catch. It was a noble effort, but
speaking of good catches, that is like the third chrono for solo Sexy Bambo, but he's back in the grave.
BM, dude. That is like... I mean, yeah, it's kind of blind there. Maybe there's another hero lingering by. Again, they don't really have to be this aggressive with the Chrono. It's not like Elements have this pressure to take these huge team fights. So I think it's totally fine if Swift Ending uses the ult in kind of a liberal manner like that to get free pickoffs. But, oh man, if you're Bambo, you've got to be feeling just shitty after that.
I'm just Shadow Demon, man. I'm a position 5. Let me live.
Just sitting there like, it doesn't even make sense. That's the tilt factor. And again, you look at the disparity in the supports, and that's where a lot of this gold gain is coming from. The upper level is a little bit more even, but we're going to start to see a difference in inventories as well. Enchantress, she's turning into a core. The Bounty Hunter doesn't really have too much yet, but Shadow Demon and Disruptor have actually nothing except Arcane Boots.
You know, Arcanes win games, man. I'm not counting them out just yet, but true. I think, like you mentioned, it's going to be pretty rough. Looking at the overall net worth chart once again, still holding on to a 5,000 gold lead for Elements. Yeah. Experience going to be a little bit less impactful just because Bone 7's been soaking up jungle farm for days and Elements have been rotating all together. Now up top, it could see Milan perhaps be a little bit greedy here. Little does he know there's a cute little anti-mage. Well, now that he reveals to wave, he's just going to book it right out of there. There's the pings. They do see that recast. They are able to go through. The dust does latch. They go for the Primal Roar. Well, goodbye, Bounty Hunter. But meanwhile, in the mid lane, there was a little bit of an engage.
Well, if only Void had a Chrono, he probably could have caught two there. But team not in a position to take the fight. And they'll just concede their Bounty Hunter for a Tier 2 tower down bottom. Tier 2 up top. Kaipi. Will they be able to bring this one down? It looks like Elements 1 want to make a defense.
Swift Glenn's Ending just kind of strolling in. There's going to be no Chrono, but I think he's just trying to tease it out. I think they think he has the Chrono. There's going to be a disruption, though, in the back line. There will be the Avalanche coming back in. The arrow is sprayed out. Not going to connect onto anything. Meanwhile, there is just going to be a chase down. Swift Ending really,
Bambo.
Really wants Fambo.
He's doing it.
Yeah, there we go.
Oh,
that is
ending.
Like the fourth one. He gets the bash, but it looks like he will be able to get the kill. I thought for a second that Bambo would be able to make it out alive.
He's
but
the
miss.
Bambo Exterminator, dude.
That is, I believe, the fourth Chrono committed for the Shadow
Bambo's
Demon.
Bambo's died 6 times, so the math adds up.
Now Sing Sing, he's going hunting here. Looking
Ron.
For that deer.
Poor LeBron.
He just got baited. Alrighty. Toss up and does not live to see the ground.
Yeah, one of the nice things about Shadowblade here is it does give Sing Sing the ability to move into a Silver Edge. Great to have against the Enchantress, gets rid of that Untouchable. Gets rid of Void's Time Lock as well. Not quite as significant, but it's still something. Bone 7 right. Now with the Manta style. Man, he is still farming so well. 13k net worth.
I think it comes down to Ken...
comfortably
an awesomely
one.
Farmed anti-mage take on this entire stack, and we had so much shade about this bounty hunter when he was picked up. So many questions, but it has been working awesome. With these track kills starting to stack, it looks mm-hmm. like elements are getting more and more gold in their favor.
Oh, they've made it work. Bounty hunter enchantress, I really think was risky here, but found the kills. Kaipi did not seem prepared for that unrelenting aggression. I think it's a little bit more expected that after that start elements have, that maybe they go back more defensive, Enchantress farms her jungle, but they were unrelenting. They spent their entire early game in enemy territory, and it was just constant pressure nonstop, and eventually they were able to find the kills to get that experience. That's the biggest thing. As long as Bounty Hunter can get level 6 in a somewhat timely manner, he can provide later utility. It's when he gets stranded at that level 3, if he dies a couple times, has nowhere to farm, that's when Bounty Hunter just looks like a completely useless hero, and of course that wasn't the case this game. Also, Blink Dagger up on Void now, so more initiation power for Swift Ending.
Yep, and looking at overall items, we got Mitch picking up a completed Pipe of Insight before finishing off those Guardian
Ooh,
Greaves, which he
I
can
like
do
that.
Very soon. This is a very beefy Darkseer. If he makes his way into the front lines of this fight, he can just vac wall, keep his whole team alive with boots and mech and pipe, and it is going to be very difficult for little heroes on Kaipi to start ripping apart elements, but they're going to get their chance pretty soon as Sing Sing Shadowbladed up.
Breaks the smoke.
Pings abound. Yeah, they know something's going on. Oh, Fambo. Poor little guy. He just wanted to help.
And he is still dead. Not much he could do there. Arrow flies across, hits range creep.
Dude,
not
that range
exactly
creep just
for.
Got completely iced.
Sure did. One outer tower remains for Kaipi. A little split push here from the Coon. What's the play here, Elements? At some point, they might want to be thinking about objectives here. They're starting to group up like they'll chip at high ground. Still with the Chronosphere, they do have some options. No Roshan for quite some while. But I think they do want to start putting some pressure on. Bone 7 with the right idea to kind of split push it out.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like there's a big successful push going on as 3-3 is sitting there. Got Necro 3s, hasn't even hatched him yet. So he can just kind of bail out at any time, hatch the Necro, spray onto the tower, and TP back to base and book it. Because there is going to be a high ground siege starting up right about now. Disruption coming out, trying to stall this out for as long as possible. But I mean, look at this Beastmaster. He's halfway through the tier 3. Necro still have a decent amount of time left. Going to be TPing back to his own base. They're looking for an engage here. There will be a blink forward from Sing Sing trying to find something. They do get the glimpse back. They are able to get the dust onto Milan. He's spraying out tracks left and right before he goes down. Bone 7 eats an arrow, but they still do end up losing their bounty hunter.
Not ideal for Elements 1. I was saying they need to start thinking about objectives, not force the high ground, and that definitely felt a little bit forced. They handed over a tier 2 tower to Bone 7, a lot of farm to the Beastmaster, and all that damage on the tier 3 up top like you were talking about, and they lost their bounty hunter in exchange for 2/3 HP on a tier 3 tower mid. Definitely not what they were looking for. I don't know. If they wanted to do that, I think you have to be a little more aggressive with the Chrono. You know, look like you're going to chip, then try to catch one. If not, just retreat. Go back and farm. Clear out the enemy's jungle. Steal their farm. Make the safe, efficient play, and then gear up for Rosh. I think that'll make their high ground siege a lot easier. It is a very long Rosh respawn, though, close to the max timer. So, a bit unfortunate for Elements. And, of course, always have to be wary of the Hawk. Kaipi already scouting it out. And now that Blink Dagger comes out on Beastmaster, as well as Darkseer.
Yeah, we've got blinks coming out left and right here. Very mobile teams on both sides. So these team fights have the potential to be spread out amongst large distances, which yeah, that's most likely going to favor Kaipi because they can just kind of keep fighting. A bunch of their cores are sustainable, whereas Elements are kind of more focused around, you know, get Mirana in the fight, get Void to latch a Chrono, and that's really it.
I love this from Bone 7. He goes for third item, Heart of Tarrasque, a very atypical anti-mage build, but makes a lot of sense here. He just needs to live through the Chrono. If he can survive through that, he's going to survive most of the time. And the heart is absolutely the perfect item to just give you raw HP, beef you up, and if he can get out of the fight, disengage, start regenning up, allows him to kind of play ping pong in these engagements and then really benefit in the long, drawn-out fights. I think it's absolutely perfect for what Kaipi have been doing this game. And when he's this far ahead, it doesn't really feel like he went all in with it. You know, we're 28 minutes in, he's 17k net worth. He'll still be able to easily farm up another big item after this, if not two more. So it's... pretty cool idea. This is pretty awesome.
All right, So it looks like Dire, they're ready to go and take another fight. They want to get something done here. Roshan's still a little bit of time on the spawn, but if Elements can go take a successful fight here, they guarantee themselves an Aegis and
IP's
most
ready.
Likely at least some high ground push. I kind of know what's going on there. There's going to be disruption to start things off. The arrow coming back on through. Not going to hit onto anyone. The pinks come out onto Swift Ending. They want to focus down the void, but poor little Bambo. He can't live through this. There's going to be a roar coming out onto Swift Ending. They're going to lock it up before he can get the chrono down. He is going to be going out. There's going to be no chrono for this fight. Elements, they're losing a lot here. Back wall coming through in the back line. Varana tries to leap away. Should be able to get out safely, but Sing Sing chasing her down. No avalanche for 3 more seconds. Do they have the time? Can they wait this out? Throwing forward the anti-mage. He lands and he crushes that kitty cat on the way down, so it looks like
Beastmaster gonna fall as well. That's another track kill for the Dire. He tried to TP home, but just couldn't make it. They had the interrupt. Looks like a good fight for Elements, but now they're gonna be punished pretty hard. Sing Sing nearby, trying to hit this damn Enchantress, but the windup is just too much. Kind of painful to watch if you're a Sing Sing fan, but they do indeed find the kill, Anti-Mage ending a killing spree. A long, drawn-out, and very chaotic fight, but in the end, Kaipe do come out victorious. A gold change pre-break-even, but the fact that the Anti-Mage lived and Elements lost their two big cores, I think does tip the scales in favor of this Radiant squad, where Anti-Mage is up to another 3,000 gold. He just bought this Heart of Tarrasque.
He is definitely feeling good. Look at that net worth. He is like at least a third of his whole net worth ahead of the Mirana now, where she was leading the charge for a long time. Yeah. So this could be the turning point. I think Bone7's got some nice broad shoulders, able to carry his whole team forward.
We're zeroed out in terms of net worth, so it is a dead even game, except for the fact that this anti-mage is disproportionately farmed compared to everyone else. So it's working out here for Kaipe. That difference in the supports is not gotten quite as gross as I thought it would. I really thought the Enchantress would start to pull further ahead, but
oh, Roche
hasn't really been able to do that. Oh, this is risky.
This is definitely risky. The smoke up comes forward. There's no scan to reveal the Radiant coming into the pit. Pylai die. He's got himself an ult. Not going to be using it just yet. Not too trigger happy, but oh, the vacuum! It catches out three in the Chronosphere, but where's the follow-up here? There's going to be some pickoff on the back line. The Illusion smacking away at the Mirana. She was stuck in the Chronosphere, wedged between Illusions. This is looking pretty good so far for the Radiant. They're getting what they want done, and it looks like Bone7, he's still up. Again, the heart keeping him so healthy. They're looking for something to glimpse back on the Enchantress. Might be able to save the life of the Disruptor who's galloping away. And Balan looking forward. Oh, he is going to get smacked away.
Well,
thought he'd be able to finish off the Tiny, but that was a little bit ambitious.
Yeah, Sing Sing baiting him in, just waiting for that Echo Saber to come back and then burst him down. Unnecessary risk from Elements 1, honestly. I mean, there's limited vision. There's a Hawk on the side of Kaipe. It's just that is a huge risk, especially when your Void is the big damage dealer. You know, if you have a position 3 Void, he can stand up here, he can stand over here, a lot of spots where he can wait to counter-initiate. In that scenario, the Void's down here. He's just sitting in the thick of it. He's the one that gets jumped on. It was a beautiful vacuum into Chrono. 4 heroes caught by the Chronosphere. That was the dream, but where was the follow-up damage? Mirana had the double Star Storm, and then that was it. Nobody died. The heart kicked in. Bone 7 survived easily, and now Roche goes the way of Kaipe. This game getting very scary for the Dire, and killing Bone7 once has been hard enough. Killing him twice now feels nigh impossible.
Arrow slightly off the mark, but poor Enchantress getting lifted back up. There's going to be a Shadowblade away. They want to disengage. They don't want to fight this out. Bone7, though, he's manning up. Again, just super, super tanky. Grabs a tally of evasion, so we're most likely looking at another Butterfly coming out.
Yes, almost no doubt. Oh, Mirana jumped on with the Primal Roar. Static Storm, Kinetic Field, the Priestess of the Moon gets put 6 feet under. Anti-Mage is not done yet, though. He wants more. Jumps in onto Swift Ending. Disruptor. Pardon me, that was the text from earlier. Looks like the Bounty Hunter will likely die. Glimpsed back to secure the kill. Very nice. Very nice indeed. 2-0, Kaipe getting even more ahead.
Yeah, it's been good for Kaipe. They had kind of a rough patch where we weren't sure if the Anti-Mage was the one getting bullied or the one left alone and his team was getting bullied, but look at him now. He's just eating these tower shots like it's nothing. He's ready to go pick up the Butterfly whenever he wants.
I think Bone7 is unkillable when he gets Butterfly. Like, how do they kill him with Heart, Butterfly, Manta? Forget about the Aegis. Forget about the Aegis. Like, there's no MKB in sight. There's... I feel like there is actually no way to deal with this hero at this stage.
Anti-Mage is a good hero, dude. You gotta keep him controlled, and Elements did a fantastic job keeping him controlled from minute 5 to 10, but after that, yeah, it's like he just fell off the radar completely, and this is what happens when you leave Anti-Mage alone for too long.
It really is. It all started with that push at the top tier 1 tower, and they had a couple of missteps there, and then it was like, okay, we need to recover, boys, we need to reevaluate, and Anti-Mage just farmed like crazy. Now they take a flight outside of the base, bold again.
Oh, Era coming back in. Oh, golly. It's a single chrono just for 33, but they should be able to get this done. No, he's hitting too slowly. There's no attack speed. Tiny comes for the follow-up. There's going to be a leap away, so Void gets some of that HP back on the back line. So there is going to be the roar as in Beastmaster's final act. He might be able to get the lockdown here, but no. Looks like Void should be getting away. But again, Bone 7 still unkillable. There's a buyback from the Bounty Hunter. He doesn't want to go down without a fight. But this poor little Bounty Hunter cannot even nip at Bone 7 on the back lines. Tiny again, just going back in.
Weird Enchantress engagement. It was like a bunch of 1v1s. It was all of these heroes hitting each other, all these chases.
Mirana?
Nice glimpse. Okay. Beautiful glimpse. And meanwhile, Bone 7 was like, all right, you guys distract him.
He
was going for barracks. He got
the
tier 3 and the
tier 4s. Yeah. At one point, he was like next to the Ancient on the fountain side.
Oh, boy.
He's feeling very, very bold. And, you know, that could come back to bite him in the ass. At this point, he's got a decent bounty on his head, but he is very difficult to lock down. And if Elements spend all their resources on him, then you've got Tiny just able to go through an avalanche, toss your entire team into oblivion.
I mean, even if they catch, let's say they catch him in a chrono and the rest of them are outside of it, I still don't think it's enough damage. Mirana at this point doesn't do much to the Anti-Mage because of Spell Shield. Void is not going to be able to auto-attack much at all because he doesn't have that much damage, and there's a 35% evasion that they have no counter for. And Enchantress, she's getting close to Ags. I mean, her damage is all right, but compared to the Anti-Mage with 3,000 HP on Strength Treads, I honestly don't think they can kill him unless Bone 7 goes really ham, like dives the fountain or something.
I mean,
ridiculous, but
he is making preparations for that. He waited till he had buyback to finish off that butterfly. So now not only is he unkillable, not only does he have Aegis, he also has buyback. They've got to kill this guy like 3 times to get him out of the fight, which takes an unreal amount of damage that I don't think Elements can put out.
Yeah, you just can't let him get this far ahead, especially when you have a draft like this. You know, Bounty Hunter, Enchantress, heroes that you know aren't going to scale the best towards the late game, and you just have to get so much done with them early on. I think one of the reasons why they've just fallen out of popularity because they're not so reliable later on. You look at supports like Shadow Demon, Kunkka, they provide so much value even into the late stages.
Are you looking at this?
Yep.
He's just walking up. He absolutely does not give a hoot. He's
sitting
there. He
doesn't give a shit, man. Enchantress just dies off on the back line. And
all right, they're trying to attack him. That's cute. Manta style and continue to focus down the racks. There's nothing 4 heroes can do against him.
They're just
they
watching
the
him destroy their base. Swift Ending even has a chrono. He's sitting there with his calculator like, guys, even if I use this chrono, is there any chance that it's going to change the state of things? I mean, Bone 7 is soloing the world right now. The rest of his team's just sitting back. I mean, I love the way he's doing it.
There's going to be a wall coming back in. The chrono does connect onto a couple. The little disruption's going to end. Another chrono, dude. All right. They get the Mirana. That's
they it. Chrono Bambo one last time. Kill him and then say, all right, you know what? That's all we needed to feel good about this game. GG, boys. I love it. I love it. Elements are not taking game one, but they lose in style, and that's an important thing to do. Kaipi looking damn good. A couple of odd rotations early on. I'm still surprised that they left Bone 7 alone for so long.